A warm greetings, everyone. Dear aspirants and viewers, at our academy, every year, around 25 physically challenged students are given free coaching under Shankar Memorial Trust. And we are very glad to inform you that one of the candidates who received this free coaching at our academy has successfully cleared the UPSC Civil Services Examination for the year 2020, and he is Mr. D. Ranjit from Tamil Nadu, who is a differently abled candidate with hearing disability. And we are also happy to inform you that he has secured the 750th rank in the UPSC Civil Services Examination 2020, and our sincere apologies for stating that he received his free coaching under the free coaching scheme of the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. So now let's move on to our article discussion. These are the list of articles that we'll be discussing in today's discussion, and they're also provided along with the page numbers of different editions and also the link for the handwritten notes in PDF format, as well as the timestamping, are given below for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. So without wasting much time, let us get into our discussion. Now, our next news discussion is going to be based on this FAQ article. So this particular FAQ article talks about the toxicity of firecrackers, and it also throws light on the steps that is taken by the Supreme Court in this regard so far. So this is the brief crux or the core idea of this FAQ article. So with that idea in mind, let's approach this FAQ article. And the syllabus covered by this article is given here. See, firecrackers is something that each and every person knows, right from LKG to grown and mature adults. And this firecrackers always brings a joy to most of us, and because of which it is burst during celebrations. And these firecrackers are made of chemicals and metallic agents. See, firecrackers have got certain key ingredients, say like that of a fuel, oxidizing agents, reducing agents, regulators, coloring agents, as well as binders. So now I will very briefly explain each of these key ingredients that is present in a firecracker. So the first comes a fuel. See, charcoal is the most common fuel that is used in firecrackers. I will repeat, charcoal is the most common fuel which is used in firecrackers, and this charcoal is also known as black powder. Now coming to the next ingredient, that is the oxidizing agents. So when you take the oxidizing agents in firecrackers, nitrates and chlorates are mainly used as oxidizing agents. And the main purpose for using these nitrates and chlorates is to burn the mixture within the fireworks and to produce oxygen. Now next comes the reducing agents. See, when you take the reducing agents, they are used to burn the oxygen which is produced by oxidizing agents. So as I told you earlier, oxidizing agents are employed to burn the mixture within the fireworks and also to produce oxygen. So in order to combat the oxygen that is produced, reducing agents like sulfur, charcoal and etc. are used, because these chemicals, they react with oxygen and form sulfur dioxide and carbon dioxide. Now next comes the regulators. See, basically regulators are used to regulate the reaction speed of the above chemicals, and it is also used as coloring agents. See, these regulators are the ones that emit different colors when crackers are burnt. So some popular metals which are used as regulators includes metals like aluminium, titanium, copper, strontium, barium, etc. So always have in mind the metals like aluminium, titanium, copper, strontium and barium are used as regulators in the fireworks. So next online comes the coloring agents, which is employed to give different colors to the firecrackers when burnt. And finally, another key ingredient is the binders. See, these binders are employed in the crackers mainly to hold the mixture of chemicals together. So these are the key ingredients or the key components in fireworks. See, generally firecrackers contain combustible chemicals. So when I say combustible chemicals, I refer to those chemicals which are able to catch fire and which are able to burn quickly and easily. So on that line, the potassium chlorate, powdered aluminium, magnesium, and salts of barium, copper, sodium, lithium, etc. are the most popular combustible chemicals which is used in fireworks. See, as you can see here, the compounds produce different colors and they also have different purposes. Now, say for example, when you take barium nitrate, they cause glittering green effects in the firecrackers. So by now I think you have a basic idea of firecrackers, the key compounds and ingredients. So now let us move on to see detrimental effects posed by the firecrackers. So let's see these effects one by one. So first of all, on combustion, the chemicals emit smoke, and some of the chemicals that is used in firecrackers are also toxic when burnt. So what happens is, when we burn firecrackers, the smoke that is produced from its burning causes air pollution by forming a smoke, and this smoke contains sulfur oxides, nitrous oxides and also a significant dust load or particulate matter of heavy metals. And this smoke or this smog has got potential to cause environmental as well as health impacts on children, aged people, animals and even birds. And the list of the hazardous or the kind of toxic nature of the ingredients in fireworks is given here. So aspirants can roughly go through it. Now coming back, see, remember that every year bursting firecrackers during Diwali and Dasara is a major cause of worsening the air quality of Delhi and NCR. See, this is not a mere claim because it has got a legal backing. And this legal backing is nothing but a report submitted by the Central Pollution Control Board based on monitoring the air quality in Delhi on the pre and post Diwali and Dasara nights. Now let's very briefly see some of the findings of this report. See, the report notes that during these days, that is during the days of Diwali and Dasara, there was an increased concentration of aluminium, potassium and barium due to the bursting of firecrackers, and this increased concentration affected the air quality. Similarly, the sulfur dioxide and also the particle matters 10 and 2.5 were found to be higher in post-Diwali day when compared to that of pre-Diwali. And especially on the day of Diwali, both the particulate matter 10 as well as the particulate matter 2.5 is found to have increased around 2 to 3.5 times. And even the concentration of aluminium was found to be 4 to 6 times higher during such occasions. Now, secondly, bursting crackers not only causes air pollution, but it also causes a lot of noise pollution because the combustion of chemicals which are used in the firecrackers produce a huge amount of sound depending on firecracker that we burn. See, apart from all these, the bursting of crackers also generate large amount of waste. So when viewed on all these aspects, we can say that the bursting crackers have got many detrimental effects more than the positive ones. But then this is just one side of the picture, because on the other hand, the Indian fireworks industry is an important part of our economy, and it has got over 6,000 crore annual turnover. And apart from this, it also provides employment opportunities directly or indirectly to over 5 lakh families. So on when seeing the other side of the picture, we can understand that we cannot simply ban the whole industry. So always have this view in mind. See, in order to combat the kind of pollution or the kind of detrimental effects caused by the firecrackers, a number of steps were taken by the government and also by the judiciary to address these detrimental effects and also to make further improvements in the firecrackers. And one such initiative is the green crackers. Now, secondly, the Supreme Court also gave directions in the matter in the 2017 case law, namely Arjun Gopal and others versus the Union of India. So as per the directions, only the improved crackers and green crackers were permitted to be manufactured and sold. And for those who are not aware, improved crackers refers to those with reduced emission. And next comes the ban on the sale of other crackers, and also ban on manufacture, sale and also the use of joint firecrackers such as series crackers. And the court also directed for the banning of barium salts in the fireworks. And one of the major reasons why the court has come up with this direction is because the barium that is used in the fireworks is added only to give attractive green color, and this is not essential for pyrotechnics. And not just that, barium salts, they also emit poisonous gas which has got the capability to cause respiratory problem even though it is a short-term exposure. So by now we have an understanding about firecrackers, their key ingredients and also their detrimental effects. And now let's see why this issue is in news. See, one of the major reasons for this issue to be in limelight is because the Supreme Court has found that many rules and above directions are being violated by manufacturers. And an example for this can be the usage of the banned barium salts for the manufacture of fireworks. So with this, we have come to the end of this FAQ discussion. So with these learned points in mind, let's move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this news article, and the article here reports about the arrest of a priest in Kerala, and this priest was arrested for trapping and killing the peacocks. So this is the news here. Now keeping the news aside, let us focus on peacocks, or the national bird of India. Now, first of all, know that only the male bird is called as a peacock, whereas the female is called a peahen. But however, they both together are classified as peafowls. See, these peafowls are swan-sized birds, and they are indigenous to the Indian subcontinent. And to be more specific, they are indigenous to India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Myanmar and Sri Lanka. See, the two popular peacock species are the blue peacock and the green peacock. When you take the blue peacock, they live in India and Sri Lanka, whereas the green peacock are found in the Java and Myanmar. Know that the peacocks are polygamous in nature, in the sense they typically have more than one mate. And when you take the initial stages, both the male as well as the female chicks are indistinguishable, or in other words, both the male and female peafowl chicks looks alike, or it is really difficult to distinguish between them. And these males, they start to develop the distinctive plumage only from 2 years of age, and they mature at around 4 years only. So when you take the average lifespan of the Indian peafowls, we can find that they can live up to 15 years in the wild. See, generally, these birds prefer to live near water bodies and are found in low altitude areas. And in the case of wild, they inhabit a wide range of habitats, say ranging from semi-dry grasslands to moist deciduous forest. And in fact, they can also be spotted around areas of human habitations, say like that of farms, villages, and also in urban areas. See, peafowls are generally omnivorous in their feeding habits, and they survive on insects, seeds, fruits, and sometimes on even small mammals. So generally, these birds forage, or they search food on the ground in small groups, which includes a single male and up to 3 to 5 females. And they even roost as a group, which usually happens on the upper branches of a tall tree. And the major reason for choosing the upper branches of a tall tree is to escape the predators. And even when these birds are agitated, they usually prefer to flee by running, and they rarely opt to take a flight. Know that the peafowls has got a prominent place in Indian literature. For example, they have an iconic status as the carrier animal of the Hindu god Kartikeya, and even Lord Krishna was always depicted with a peacock feather in his headdress. And when you take the Buddhist philosophy also, the peacock represents wisdom. And not just that, even the peacock and its feather motifs are prominent features in Mughal architecture. And in fact, the peacock and the peacock feather are still a popular motif, which is found to be widely used in logos, text
textile patterns as well as in multiple designs. Now coming to the threats towards the Indian peafowl. See, usually the threats arise due to the demand for their beautiful feathers, since they are used for a lot of decorative purposes. And apart from that, they are also hunted and killed by poachers for the purpose of meat as well. And at times, they are also killed for inhabiting nearby farms, since they prefer to feed on crop gains, which could actually cause losses to the farmers. But however, the Indian peafowl has been granted special conservation efforts due to its status as the national bird of India. That is, hunting of the national bird is illegal in our Indian country. And apart from that, they are also given full protection under the Wildlife Act of 1972. And when you take their conservation, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, or shortly known as IUCN, Red List, classifies the blue peafowl as a species of least concern. But then the IUCN classifies the green peacock to be an endangered species, and a main reason for this is because the population of the green peacock has declined significantly due to overhunting and also because of the destruction of a large part of their natural habitat. So these are some important points that we need to have in mind whenever we learn about peacocks. So now let's get on to the next part of our Hindu news analysis. Now look at this news article. This article reports about an initiative that is taken by the American Institute of Indian Studies. So as a part of this initiative, the ballads, folklore and also the songs of the Langa Maganyar artist are being preserved for the purpose of documentation as well as digitization. So this is the crux of the news here. Now based on this context, let us know about Langa Maganyar community, which is in limelight in today's article. See, the Langa and the Maganyar communities are the original exponents of Sufi music, which is the devotional music of the Sufis. So basically, they are Muslim communities who lived for many centuries in the Thar desert of western Rajasthan. Or to be more specific, they primarily occupy the Barmer and the Jaisalmer districts of the state of Rajasthan, and also in the villages along the border of Pakistan. Have in mind, both these communities comprise of traditional musicians, and they earn or they make their living by singing for high caste patrons. And both these communities sing in the same dialect, but then it is not thoroughly same. That is, their styles and repertoires, that is the kind of themes or the dances or the various properties they use, may differ based on the taste of their patrons. That is, the styles and repertoires of Langar will be different to that of the Maganyar, and both of them are shaped by the demand or the taste of the patrons to whom they are singing for. So both these communities are famous for their classical folk music, and in fact they represent the voice of Rajasthan. See, when you take the Langas, they are patronized by the Muslim Sindhi Sipais, and this Sindhi Sipai, they belong to the family of Chandravanshi Rajputs, and they form a large part of the Muslim Rajput populations of Marwar and Mewar. Now, on the contrary, when you take the Maganyar community, they mainly sing for Hindu patrons. See, I have in mind, both these communities are made up of Muslim musicians, but still the Maganyar, they opt for Hindu patrons, and they sing songs in praise of the Hindu deities, and they also celebrate festivals like Diwali and Holi. And in fact, they still sing for the Hindu Yajmans on auspicious occasions like Holi, Diwali, and also on other auspicious occasions like that of weddings. Now talking about the musical instruments used by these communities, see, the Langa's main traditional instrument is the Sindhi Sarangi, and when you take the Maganyas, their principal instrument is the Kamacha. See, both this Sindhi Sarangi and the Kamacha, they are both stringed instruments with skin membrane sounding boards, and they have many sympathetic strings. And apart from this main
instrument, both the communities, that is both Langars and Maganyas, they also sing and play the Dholak, which is a double-headed barren drum, then the Kartal, which is the wooden clappers, and the Morcham or the Jaws harp, and also the harmonium during their performances. See, an important point to note here is that the Langa and the Maganyar, they sing a specific raga for a specific time of the day or the specific time of the year, or even for different occasions, say like that of weddings, births and ceremonies. So these are some basic facts about the Langa and Maganyars. So with these learned points in mind, let's get on to the next news discussion. Now let us take up this news article. So this article basically reports about two products from the Kerala state which has recently got the GI tag, and they are the Edayur chili and the Kudiyattur mango. So in this context, let us very briefly know about these two products. See, Edayur chili, which is also called as Edayur mulakku, is a local cultivar which is found to be cultivated in all these places. See, now you may have a question that what does this word local cultivar means? See, a local cultivar refers to a particular variety of a plant whose characteristics have been controlled by the people in the way it has been bred. And when you take this chili, it belongs to the capsicum annuum, and the crop is traditionally cultivated in hills, hillocks and also in latritic fields. As per documents from the Edayur Grama Panchayat, it is said that the cultivation of this chili in this particular area has been in existence for at least 150 years. That is, since 150 years, this particular chili has been cultivated in this area. See, from this Edayur, where this chili has been cultivated, large quantity of this chili will move to nearby markets and also to districts to be used for making kondattam, which is nothing but a sun-dried curd chilies. So due to high passion for this fried kondattam, the chili has become an integral part of each and every meal of this area, and it is also considered to be a delicacy for the people of this and nearby regions. And in fact, each and every homeland in Edayur make sure they have a small garden of this cultivar. See, one unique aspect of this Edayur chili is that, know that Edayur chili is a chief cultivar of this area with least pungency. See, here the word pungency means the condition of having a very strong and also a sharp smell or flavor. Now talking about the uniqueness of this chili, see, all its uniqueness owes to the genetic makeup of the cultivar, the distant environmental condition of the cultivation area, and also the traditional techniques which were employed in the cultivation. All these aspects together contribute to the uniqueness of this particular chili. Now let's move on to the next product, which is the Kudiyattur mango. See, this Kudiyattur mango is a popular and also a tasty traditional mango cultivar of Kudiyattur and also the nearby Gram Panchayats of the Kannur district in North Kerala. So this mango has got a maximum spread in Kudiyattur Panchayat, and you can find the trees of this mango in every home, school, public institution and also in roadsides of Kudiyattur Panchayat. So, or in other words, and this reason makes Kudiyattur the mango village of Kannur. See, even though this cultivar is most popularly known as Kudiyattur mango, it has got other names as well, and they are the Nambiar mango, the Kannapuram mango, etc. So basically, this mango is famous for its appearing color, that is the orange-yellow color of its flesh, and also for the rind and excellent taste and the flavor which it possess. And apart from this, another important speciality of this mango is that the ripe fruits do not show speckles or patches on the skin like that of the ordinary mangoes, and this tendency makes it more appealing in the market. See, the uniqueness of this Kudiyattur mango is further enhanced by the combination of specific environmental conditions of the area. Another major important advantage of this mango is the earliness in flowering. See, the earliness in flowering spotted in these mangoes is another advantageous feature of the cultivar. And this mango harvest, it usually finishes before the onset of the southwest monsoon. And this earliness actually enhances the market value of this mango. Apart from these two, some of the other products from the Kerala state which has got a geographical indication tag is given below for your reference. So aspirants, please go through it. So with this, let's wind up this discussion and move on to the next news article.
Now for our next news discussion, I have chosen two major judgments that were passed by the two Indian high courts, namely the Delhi High Court and the Kerala High Court. And both these judgments are related to the pendency of court cases in India. See, I have chosen these articles mainly because you can make use of these points in your mains answers whenever you have a topic related to judicial pendency. So come, let us move on to see both these judgments one by one. So for our first discussion, let us take the judgment made by the Delhi High Court. Now this judgment is related to the juveniles who are accused of petty offences. So in this judgment, the court is ordered for the immediate release of those minors whose case inquiry remain inconclusive or whose case inquiry have not met with a judgment for a period longer than 1 year. Now this judgment has been made as a response to a submission which was filed by the Delhi Commission for Protection of Child Right. So in its submission, the commission has highlighted that as on 30th of June 2021, around 1,903 inquiries against the juveniles relating to petty offences were found to be pending before the Juvenile Justice Boards in the capital. So it is based on this submission only the court has come up with such a decision. Now, having said that, let's see the legal backing behind this decision of the Delhi High Court. See, when you look at section 14 of the Juvenile Justice Act, you can find that the act mandates for the automatic termination of inquiries against a minor who is alleged of criminal activities. And this automatic termination is prescribed in situations where the probe remains inconclusive after 4 months and a maximum extension of up to 2 months from the date of the first production of the child before the Juvenile Justice Board. So in simple words, the Act mandates for the entire inquiry to be completed within a maximum of 6 months. And note that the 4 month period, which is mentioned in section 14 of the Act, starts right after the date of the first production of the child before the Juvenile Justice Board. See, one major problem with the proceeding of cases related to juveniles is the act of age determination. So to understand better, in order to begin an inquiry, the concerned authorities have to first determine the age of the subject. And this process of age determination itself takes a substantial time, because of which matters remain pending before the Juvenile Justice Boards for a period longer than the maximum 6 month period which is prescribed in section 14 of the concerned act. Now, added to this difficulty in determining the age of the accused comes the prevailing COVID-19 situation. So all these reasons together, they make it really difficult to produce the accused juveniles before the Juvenile Justice Board. So as a result, hundreds of matters, including the petty offences, have been stuck at various stages for a period much longer than the prescribed 4 months. So on that line, this decision which is made by the Delhi High Court is actually a welcome step, because even the mere pendency of an inquiry against a child is certainly stigmatic, and it has also got the potential to highly impact the dignity of the concerned child. So these are the important takeaway points from this news article. Now let's move on to the next court judgment. Now coming to the next judgment, see, this is a judgment made by the Kerala High Court, and this judgment is related to the persons with criminal records who are traveling abroad. So in its judgment, the court held that The pendency of a criminal proceeding against a person shall not bar that particular person from obtaining a passport for traveling abroad. So that means in his judgment, the court is directed that when the criminal proceedings are pending against a person, the court shall grant permission for that particular person's period of travel or the period for which the passport can be issued to that person. Now see, this is because, as we all know, criminal trials takes ages to complete. And this has got even more worse with the corona pandemic, because the pandemic has halted the trials in many courts across our country. So at such an instance, instead of holding the passport or barring the person from traveling abroad, it would be of great significance if the person is granted permission to travel abroad. Because such a move enables the process of balancing the fundamental right of a citizen to travel abroad as well as the need to ensure the presence of the accused during trial. But then, however, while considering the application, the court held that it is really important for the magistrate to consider the stage of the criminal proceedings and also to take into account the duration within which the trial may take place. And most importantly, the criminal antecedents and the past conduct of the accused, as well as the nature and the gravity of the crime, should be looked into before arriving at a decision. And this judgment of the Kerala High Court is also a significant move when it comes to the issue of judicial pendency in Indian courts. So these are the takeaway points here, and now let's get on to the next news discussion. Now look at this news article. This article is about an incident of ammonia leak. So the news here is that yesterday there was an accident in an ice factory at Chennai, and this accident led to the ammonia leak. So this is the context here. Now based on this context, we will see some important points about the ammonia, which is mentioned in today's news, its various applications, and also its harmful impact both in human body as well as in environment. So first of all, we all know that the chemical formula for ammonia is NH3. So when I say NH3, it means that ammonia is made up of one nitrogen atom and three hydrogen atoms. So basically, this ammonia is a gas and it is colorless, and it is a gas which is lighter than air and also a gas which readily dissolves in water. So whenever we hear about ammonia, the first thing that comes to our mind is the kind of pungent smell which this gas contains. Yes, ammonia has got a very strong smell, and this smell is similar to that of urine. And this unpleasant smell of ammonia helps in detecting the gas by most people, even if it is present in small amounts. And another important fact about ammonia is that it is a non-flammable gas. In the sense, it is not capable of catching fire or burning that easily. But however, when it gets mixed with the air at certain concentrations, then there are high chances for it to explode if ignited. So that means at certain concentrations, ammonia is flammable. See, ammonia solutions are alkali, and they can be corrosive. So when I say ammonia solutions, it means that I refer to solution of ammonia in water. And if you have noticed, I said solutions of ammonia are alkali. So for those who are not aware of what this word alkali means, see, alkalis are strong bases that has got the potential to turn the litmus paper from red to blue, and these are also bases which has got the potential to react with acids in order to yield neutral salts. And similarly, I also said ammonia can be corrosive. See, corrosive is nothing but a substance which has got the capability to damage or to destroy other substances which comes into contact with that particular substance, and it is able to cause the damage by means of a chemical reaction. So I'll repeat, ammonia solutions are alkali and they are also corrosive when concentrated.
and know that ammonia solutions may also be called ammonia hydroxide and aqueous ammonia. So by now we have a basic understanding about ammonia, its chemical composition and its properties. So now let us see the sources of ammonia. See, ammonia is made by bacteria and decaying plants and animals. And since the bacteria, plants and animals occur everywhere, ammonia is found in water, soil and also in air. Apart from this, ammonia is also produced by the body when the proteins break down. Now, talking about its applications, see, this ammonia is actually a forerunner to various important nitrogen compounds. That includes urea, phenol, amino acids, hydrogen cyanide, nitric acids, soda ash and many more. And while doing our schooling, we ourselves would have come across ammonia in our chemistry lab. And as we all have witnessed in the laboratory, the ammonia gas is changed into a liquid and then it is used for the purpose of research and studies. And likewise, it is also used in industries for the production of various products, say like that of polymers, fertilizers, synthetic fibers, explosives, refrigerants and also for cleaning agents. And additionally, ammonia also contributes in a significant manner to the nutritional needs of the land organisms by serving as a precursor to food and fertilizers. And it also serves as a building block for the synthesis of many pharmaceutical products. And when you take the household purposes, see, ammonium hydroxide, which is also known as household ammonia, is an ingredient which is found in almost all household cleaning products, which we use to clean a variety of surfaces, say like that of tubs, sinks, toilets, tiles, etc. See, one major reason why ammonia is being used in such cleaning products is because this ammonia gas has got the potential to evaporate quickly, and it is due to this rapid evaporation it is used in a variety of cleaning products. And in fact, it is commonly used in the glass cleaning solutions in order to help avoid the streaking. As I said earlier, ammonia is found to be in use across varied sectors and for varied purposes. So, or in other words, there are high chances for us to come in contact with ammonia in our day-to-day life itself. In spite of finding applications in the day-to-day lifestyle, scientists consider ammonia to be a toxic gas by inhalation. See, to put it in better words, these ammonia fumes, they have a sharp and pungent odor, and this odor has got the capability to cause irritation to the nose, eyes, skin and also to the mucous membrane. And apart from this, they can also damage our respiratory tract, and also exposure to high concentration ammonia gas can even lead to permanent lung damage and death. So far we saw about the detrimental effects of ammonia on human beings. So now let's see the impact created by ammonia on. See, ammonia is toxic when it comes to aquatic organisms. See, if ammonia is directly spilled into a surface water, or when a particular aquatic animal or an aquatic organism comes into contact with ammonia, will be harmed. Similarly, ammonia is also highly toxic to freshwater invertebrates, and it is for this reason the water that is contaminated with the fertilizer ammonia should not be allowed to enter any storm drains, rivers, ditches, wetlands, lakes or any other water bodies. Similarly, be aware that ammonia vapors are toxic even to dairy, swine and poultry livestock. When you take plants, ammonia can have a direct toxic effect on vegetations or the changes in species composition because of nitrogen deposits. And when you take in the case of atmosphere, ammonia can bind to other gases to form ammonium, which has particularly negative impacts on cardiovascular as well as on respiratory health systems. So with this, let us wind up this news article. So in this article, we saw about ammonia, its sources, applications and also the detrimental effects it has on human beings as well as on our environment. So now let's move on to the next news discussion.
Now look at this news article. So the news here is that the Indian Bank has entered into a memorandum of understanding with the non-banking financial companies. And this MOU was done to enable the priority sector lending. So this is the crux of the news here. Now based on this context, we will now see as to what is a non-banking financial company, and we will also see on how it is different from that of a bank. See, a non-banking financial company is a company that is registered under the Companies Act of 1956. So basically, this non-banking financial company will be involved in the business of loans and advances. And it is also involved in the acquisition of shares, stocks, bonds, debentures, and also securities that are issued by the government or local authority or even other marketable securities of a like nature. Also know that even those companies whose principal business is to receive deposits under any scheme or arrangement, either in one lump sum or in installments, will also come under a non-banking financial company, and generally such companies are classified as residuary non-banking company. But always remember, a non-banking financial company does not include any institution whose principal business is related to agricultural activity or industrial activity. And also, it doesn't deal with the purchase or sale of any goods other than that of securities. Similarly, these non-banking financial companies is not related to any services or the sale, purchase or construction of an immovable property. So always have this point in mind, because UPSC can use this as a twisting statement to confuse the aspirants. Now talking about the difference between the banks and the non-banking financial companies, see, both banks and NBFCs, they lend and they make investments. So when viewed in that perspective, the activities of NBFCs are found to be closer to that of banks. But then, however, there are three major differences between these two bodies which you should be knowing. So the first difference is that these non-banking financial companies cannot accept demand deposits, and they do not form a part of the payment and settlement system. Secondly, NBFC cannot issue checks which are drawn on itself. And then the third difference is that, unlike in the case of banks, the deposit insurance facility of deposit insurance and the credit guarantee corporation is not available to the depositors of the non-banking financial companies. So these are some important and basic points that we need to have in mind whenever we come across the non-banking financial companies during our preparation. So always have these points in mind, especially its functioning areas and also on how it is different from that of a bank. So with this, we are done with our article discussion for today. And now let us move on to the next segment of our Hindu news analysis, which is going to be our practice question discussion. So for our first question discussion, let us take this question, which is related to the firecrackers topic. So the question goes like, which among the following elements or metals and their compounds are prohibited in the manufacture of firecrackers? Statement 1, strontium chromate. Statement 2, antimony. Statement 3, lithium. Statement 4, lead. And statement 5, barium salts. Note that the Supreme Court in July 2017 passed an interim direction which prohibited the use of compounds of antimony, lithium, mercury, arsenic and lead to the manufacture of fireworks. And this order was made absolute in September 2017. In the same order, and the use of strontium chromate in the manufacture of fireworks was also
prohibited. And finally, in Arjun Gopal case, about which we saw in our article, the Supreme Court banned the use of barium salts as well. So that means all the five options which are given here are correct, and that makes option D, that is 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 to be right here. Now look at this question. It gives us two columns. In one column there is a list of tribes, and then in the next column we have the state to which they belong to. So the first pair is Irulas and Odisha, and when you take the second pair it is Langas and Rajasthan, and the third pair is Mankida and Bihar. So when you take the first pair, this pair is incorrect because the Irulas are a Dravidian ethnic group who live in the Indian states of Tamil Nadu, Kerala and Karnataka and not in the state of Odisha. So that means the first pair is wrong. The second pair, which is Langas and Rajasthan. See, from our discussion itself, we can infer that this pair is correct here because our whole discussion was concerned about the Langas community. Now thirdly comes Mankida and Bihar. See, the Mankida are nomadic ethnic group of India who live in Odisha and not in Bihar. So that makes the third statement to be wrong as well. So since only the second statement is right here, the correct answer here will be option B, that is 2 only. Now look at this question. Consider the following statements with reference to the office of the Controller General of Patents, Designs and Trademarks. Statement 1, this office uses GI tags in India. Statement 2, it comes under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. See, the first statement here is right, that is the Controller General of Patents, Designs and Trademarks, they issue the GI tags in India. So that makes the first statement right. But coming to the second statement, see, this Controller General of Patents, Designs and Trademarks, they are not under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation, but rather they come under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So therefore, the right answer here will be option A, that is 1 only. Now look at this question related to ammonia. So the question goes like, which of the following are the properties of ammonia? Statement 1, absence of color. Statement 2, lighter than hair. Statement 3, strong smell. Statement 4, alkali. Statement 5, corrosive nature. See, from our discussion itself, we can infer that all the five properties given here are exhibited by ammonia. So that makes option D, that is option 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 to be the right answer here. So with this, we have come to the end of today's Indo News analysis. And if you guys have liked my video, then don't forget to like, comment and share. And of course, subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation. Thank you.